2017. Debates on motions with no legislative effect. Stimulating internal demand and opening up new visitee sources. Members who wish to speak on the motion will please press the request to speak button and now call upon Mr. Shu Ka-fai to speak and move the motion. Mr. Peter Shu. Thank you, Madam Deputy. I move that the motion is printed on the agenda be passed. Madam Deputy, this motion is called Stimulating Internal Demand and Opening Up New Visitor Sources. So early last year, I submitted this motion. I thought it could be debated upon last November, but there are so many problems with the LegCo. So it's only today that we can debate on this. So it's been 1 year down the road, but the motion is more timely rather than outdated. The budget delivered last month supports the premise of this motion, and that is the government's fiscal reserve is huge and has got a stable income. And after the unification, starting from 2003, the financial year, up to now, there has never been any deficit. And in the last budget, 2017, we have a record high surplus, reaching $138 billion, and the fiscal reserve has reached a record high of $1.1 trillion. And the government expects that there will be a surplus in the next 5 years. And 5 years later, the reserve may reach $1.2 trillion. And going by our experience, it's just the estimate. And I think the ultimate figure will be much higher than these. As I have been advocated along, since the public coffers are flush with money and we have a stable income, the government must make the good use of this financial situation and launch more measures to return our wealth to people and stimulate internal demand. It should say for the rainy days and also do something to stimulate the economy. Now, in terms of stimulating internal demand, the budget said that 40% of the surplus, around $53.8 billion, to be shared with the members of the public, including the rate waiver, profits and salary tax exemption, extra 2 months' pay for CSSA recipients, etc. There should be land exemption, rent exemption for people, etc. And later on, the government has launched the caring and sharing scheme, and 2.8 million people will be benefiting and be given $4,000 each, and the expenditure is $11 billion. A total of $64 billion will be spent. The government has responded to public aspirations and to try to benefit the public with this huge fiscal reserve. That's the responsibility. And the government should share such surplus with the members of public and return wealth to people. And people can get more cash, and we spent more than as a result. So that's what I meant by stimulating internal demand. I hope and appeal to members of the public to spend the money in Hong Kong, and that it will help the various traders, including catering, retail, and logistics and transport sectors. Some people may ask for the retail sector has experienced a decline in volume for the past 2 years, and it has made a comeback in recent past, and the trend is on the upward side. So why does the government still have to give out more money? Well, that kind of good condition can't stay forever. It looks good now, but then it doesn't mean there are no worries at all. We must prepare for the rainy days and be prepared to face challenges and hidden worries and hidden risks. Now, if business gets better, the landowners are very quick to increase the rental. And at the same time, the unemployment rate has declined to 2.9%, a record low in 20 years. And underemployment is just 1%. It shows that we are short of labor in Hong Kong. Now, without importing more overseas workers, I believe that different sectors will vie fiercely for labours and the wages will rise. Now, apart from these, different people have been telling me, say, on 1st of October on the mainland, the import tariffs for different consumption products have been adjusted downwards. They cover food, pharmaceuticals, cosmetic products, health products, wear and daily groceries, etc. Over 187 products have been covered. The tariff has been dropped, has been decreased to 7.7%, and it's good news to the import trade. But for the retail sector, it's altogether a different thing, because with the lowering of the import tariffs, it means that the prices of commodities in the two places will get closer. And there is also the very popular online shopping pattern, and mainlanders will not be more would not like to come to Hong Kong to shop anymore. So in face of this, we must develop our tourism industry substantially. The tourism industry has taken up 5% of GDP in Hong Kong, and together with retail, catering, logistics, import and export, they employ a total of 700 of thousands of workers, and that will affect our livelihood. On retail sector, while it is intertwined with the tourism sector, in recent months, the sales volume of retail has been on the rise, and one of the reasons being that we are seeing more tourists. In 2017, we saw 58 million travelers coming to Hong Kong, and 76% of them are from the mainland. And the mainlanders are spending a lot in Hong Kong and takes up 35 to 40% of the total retail turnover in Hong Kong. So the trend is good. In the budget this year, we said that there will be an extra $396 million to be allocated to the tourism sector. That is a rise of 60% compared to last year. Of course, I welcome that. But with the such a huge surplus, we used to have the waiver of the license fees for the tourists, for travel agents, hotels, and restaurants. And this time, we are not seeing that. We are disappointed. Now, $22 million will be allocated to the tourism board to help with taking forward the development blueprint for Hong Kong's tourism industry. That is good. And with such a huge surplus, I think more should be given to the Hong Kong TB. But then for our support infrastructures for the tourism industry, apart from developing the software, hardware is also essential. What do we mean by hardware in Hong Kong? We must ask our Hong Kong residents to be friendly to the tourists. We must come up with the support facilities. Hong Kong, Zhuhai, Macau Bridge and the XRL will be commissioned very likely this year, and the bridge is going to be completed. Mainland visitors will come more, to Hong Kong. And I think that would be another tourism peak for Hong Kong after the 2203, where the IBS was implemented. Let's look at the Bay Area. It's got a population of 60 million people, and Hong Kong's economy will be developed further because of this. Well, if we want to do well, we must be prepared, and we must enhance our own reception capability. We must do the best job. In 2013, we conducted a capacity and receiving capability study, and there was no cap imposed on the number of visitors. But then it suggested that we should enhance ourselves on many aspects, including, say, at busy tourist destinations, how should we divert the tourists properly and make sure that the tourists have a happy time in Hong Kong and that local residents will not be affected. Now, in the past few years, we've been trying to do something to divert the tourists at different spots, but I don't think we have done a good enough job. Many local residents are worried about too many tourists flocking to Hong Kong. And we all understand this because in some districts or locations in Hong Kong, inconvenience is being caused to local Hong Kong residents. So given the large fiscal surplus, I think the government must come up with more support tourism facilities, for example, making available more shopping spots so that these are located away from residential development areas. Now, some other members have said this. Now, Madam Deputy, in your district, there are so many tourists gathering, and if the right transport facilities are not put in place, local residents will be affected adversely. So I hope that the government can strengthen its work in that aspect and try to come up with the best transport support infrastructure. We want to do business, and we have to strike a balance between this and local residents' sentiments. Now, it's easy to chase away the tourists, but it will be difficult to attract them back to return. So if we are to chase away the tourists just because you want to please local residents, I don't think that's a good solution. So as I said, how can the government come up with more support structures? I mean, this is something that Hong Kong residents would like the government to do more on. And in the long term, the government should review the one trip per week and measure, and also for should we be expanding the cities to be covered by IVS? We will be seeing the Hong Kong Zhuhai Macau Bridge commissioned, and the tourists will be much convenienced. And at the same time, if we open up the IVS more, then that will do good to Hong Kong, and it will also bring more economic benefits to Hong Kong. And then for the general public, they will have more jobs. They will see possibly a wage hike as well. Now, in order to improve livelihood, the first thing to do is to develop our economy. If that can't be done, how can we help those in need? I know that individual members might have worries over tourists. They are moving amendments. I respect their views. Hong Kong people's feelings are important, but how can we earn more and develop Hong Kong's economy is something equally essential. I believe that the legislature, whether it is the pro-establishment or opposition camp members, they won't see that Hong Kong is suffering from fewer businesses and so on. So I hope that the government can try to do more on providing hardware to allay the worries of the other members. That's all I want to say. Thank you, Madam Deputy.
I now propose the question to you that the motion moved by Honorable Hsu Ka-fai be passed. Five members will move amendments to this motion. This council will conduct a joint debate on the motion and the amendments. Our call upon members who move the amendments to speak in the following order: Dr. KWOK Ka-ki, Mr. Si-wing, Mr. Michael TIEN, Mr. Wu Chi-wai, and Mr. Lam Cheuk-ting, but they may not move amendment at this stage. Dr. KWOK Ka-ki. Thank you, Madam Deputy. I thank Mr. Hsu Ka-fai for moving this origin to stimulate internal demand, and tourism has always been a key pillar of our economy. It's a great contributor to our economic development. After the war, Hong Kong became a manufacturing center and also a famous tourism attraction and destination because of the beauties, scenery that we were called the Pearl of the Orient. But in recent years, because of the development of tourism and the number of visitors, high number of visitors, we see, apart from the economic impetus, there are challenges. And in some areas, people are affected. In some districts, as those mentioned in my amendments, West Kowloon, Yunong, Tuen Mun, Shang Shui, Chuen Wan, Tu Kwa Wan, Hong Ham, and so on. For these, for people living in these districts, they have to suffer a lot. Because mainly we're talking about mainland visitors. In terms of the composition of the visitors group, according to the Hong Kong Tourism Board, mainland visitors, whether they would stay overnight or not, account for a high percentage, totaling 4.3 million. And we have, additionally, 1.12 million visitors from places apart from the mainland. Why is that? In the past, visitors from other countries did not pose so much problems to our people. Mainland visitors do account for a big share of tourists, but there are 2.7 million mainland visitors who wouldn't stay overnight in Hong Kong. It's difficult to guess what they are here for. Is it for sightseeing, or are they great good traders, or just shoppers? After the introduction of a one visit per week arrangement, we have seen a little bit of improvement in great good traders' problems. I would like the officials to visit Shang Shui, Tuen Mun, Yuen Long, North NT, especially during long holidays for mainlanders. You see that the places are all overcrowded with lots of mainland visitors, and they usually purchase not something of high value. They buy daily they buy groceries, daily necessities. And they also buy from shops specializing in such supplies. They will open their suitcase on the street, or they will go to an industrial building where there are gold warehouses converted to serve them. And you can't even get past the passageway because there are so many visitors. I can't say whether that is good for Hong Kong tourism. The mayor of city wrote this in his blog. It's a criticism from him. Some the netizens of Taiwan had their dreams or the imagination about Hong Kong shattered after the first visit. And we have visitors from other countries, such as Taiwan, Japan, Southeast Asian countries, Australia. They are also major sources of our visitors, our tourists. We should not just have one source of visitors. Particularly, if they only come to shop, there will be problems of various sorts. Maybe I can quote from a female Taiwan netizen, her criticism. The streets are crowded, the shoppers are not polite and considerate, and then there are too many mainland visitors, the local characteristic is a loss. It's difficult to have good food. Rental is high, the master chefs have all retired. The small shops are all catering to the needs of mainland visitors. There are so many the goldsmith shops and pharmacies. We want to diversify our tourism. Taiwan, by the way, is a main source of tourists coming to Hong Kong. Now the government is going to spend billions of dollars to be given to the Tourism Commission and the Hong Kong Tourism Board at this time. This year round, the money will be given to the Ocean Park. And then last year, there was the additional grant to the Hong Kong Disneyland through the unequal contract. And yet, we have been criticized in this way by some tourists. So our reputations, which we spent years to build up, has been tarnished. And we know that in the past, South Korea and Taiwan, because of some disputes with China, such as the deployment of the threat defense system, missile defense system, mainland cut the number of visitors to South Korea, and Taiwan also had a similar problem, and their tourism industry was affected. According to South Korean Tourism Authority, they have improved the situation because of visitors from other countries, Middle East, Vietnam, Mongolia, and Russia, and Kazakhstan, have been more important sources now. And Taiwan also saw the reduction of tour groups from mainland after there was a dispute with the mainland. And Taiwan came up with a new tourism policy. Although there are now fewer mainland visitors, but international visitors amount to the 10.7 million in number, a record high. What I want to say is that if Hong Kong wants to maintain its competitive edge as a sustainable tourism industry, we should not rely on just one source of tourists. You may think it's a market easy to develop, but the mainland is going to reduce the tariffs for cosmetics and other goods. So are we going to see so many visiting shoppers? And also when they get used to this destination, they will try to go somewhere else in the past 10 odd years. What we are doing is to cater to the needs of mainland visitors, and at the same time, we will be deterring the visitors from other countries. They don't like Hong Kong anymore, or Hong Kong will no longer be their primary destination or destination of choice. We'll have to expand two times or three times the efforts we did in the past to attract them back. In the anti-West, Hong Kong, and other districts, there's too much reliance on IVS visitors from mainland. This is not going to benefit the local the tourism in Hong Kong. The tourism industry should mend its ways. Don't rely on this old formula of business. I hope members can support my amendment.
Mr. Yu Si-wing, thank you, President. I'm grateful to Mr. Shiu Ka-fai for moving this motion on stimulating internal demand and opening up new facility sources. In the original motion, there's emphasis on provision of additional tourism support facilities. Now, Hong Kong needs to move towards a diversified economy, but tourism remains a pillar industry here. Our service industry account for some 93% of our GDP in 2014. Among services industry, tourism is a pillar industry. The contribution to GDP is only 5% or 7% of the workforce, but still there's some serious rippling effect. the food, the catering industries, transportation industries, and other industries are all affected by the tourism industry. The World Tourism Organization projects that the tourism's industries' extended contribution to GDP amounts to 16.8%, and related employment account for almost 50% of the workforce. Now, these days, with ease of travel, traveling is something common, especially on the mainland with the improving economy, many are traveling abroad. So the tourism is has some bright future. That's why I suggest that we should use tourism to boost our economic growth. Now, in last year, there were 58.5 million visitors to Hong Kong, an increase of 3.2%, more than 5% stayed overnight. It's because in recent years, we have seen fewer cases of rudeness towards visitors. And also, the government has spent resources to provide more tourism facilities. So that's why the tourism industry was able to turn the trend around from 2 years ago when there was a drop in visitor numbers. Now, there are plenty of opportunities because Hong Kong is still going to be integrated with the mainland. Within a five-hour living circle, we're talking about a population of 300 million. And these are potential markets with high-spending visitors. Also, we should promote a multi-destination journey going through Hong Kong, and that will help to bring in more overnight stay visitors. Still, we must not overlook the hidden concerns and challenges ahead. In terms of hidden concerns, that in the past, there were 30 million inbound visitors. But then only 24% are visitors from overseas, and that is not good for our healthy development. And also, for high-spending visitors, we don't have enough competitiveness. The Ocean Park and the Disney Park are facing direct competition from the Huangqin theme park and the Shanghai Disneyland. And then for tourism facility support facilities, hotel rates are on the high side, and that put off overseas visitors. And also, there is shortage of drivers, and so there are not enough parking spaces for coach buses as well that restrict our growth. And also, limited MICE facilities also restrict our growth. Now, we have unique country parks and so on, but not all are accessible. So that doesn't help us in developing ecotourism. So now the Tourism Commission has published a development blueprint for Hong Kong's tourism industry. There are short-term, medium-term, and long-term initiatives and measures for implementation in the coming 5 years. That is good. But then that covers mostly short-term measures. There are fewer medium to long-term measures. For example, Kai-tech development and Lantau, that's under the charge of Development Bureau, West Kowloon Cultural District under the Home Affairs Bureau. And then the Commerce and Economic Development Bureau is responsible for developing the Disneyland and the Convention and Exhibition Center. So the responsibilities are scattered among different bureaus and departments. So the blueprint actually just puts together all the work of different bureau departments, but there is not a long-term vision. Now, if it is a long-term strategy, then it should be the financial secretary which takes charge. So there will be long-term, medium-term goals, and then different, and then the CDB would coordinate the efforts of different bureau departments, and then things would work better that way. Now, of course, the blueprint is published, but I hope the CDB would complete all the short-term initiatives as scheduled. this will help our tourism industry to develop further. On the blueprint, I would like to say this. First, we need to enhance the transit function of the Hong Kong International Airport so as to consolidate our position as an aviation hub. Now, Hong Kong International Airport offers many different routes and destinations with comparable fares. That's why it's been an important transit center. Mainland airports are now actively developing more routes, so we face a stiff competition. For example, the Baiyun Airport. In 2011, the duplication rate of routes with Hong Kong Airport was 59%, but that's now gone up to 68%, so we're facing very stiff competition. Now, with the Hong Kong-Macau Chi-wai Bridge soon to be commissioned, and the XRL soon to be commissioned, that will bring more business to the Hong Kong International Airport. Now, there will be a transit building, so for passengers coming or taking the coach to take the plane here in Hong Kong, there will be proper facilities. For this transit center, it will take time for it to be completed, but I don't think we can wait any further. So during the interim, the government should consider short-term measures so that we won't lose these transit passengers to other airports. What about the Sky Pier? We can make use of the existing facilities. So passengers coming by coaches could go through clearance there at the Sky Pier. So we're able to keep such passengers, and at the same time we're able to stream these passengers to different terminals. And secondly, we need to upgrade our infrastructure, and we need to develop high-quality ecotourism. Now, tourist destinations in Hong Kong face immense challenges in recent years. We need to plow in much resources to build more tourist destinations. For example, Disneyland, we're going to have to plow in another $19 billion in the next few years. Now, we have rich natural resources, so we should develop we have good country park networks, so we should develop ecotourism. But then there aren't enough facilities like power supply, water supply, accessibility, or toilet facilities and so on. The condition is not desirable right now. So the government should consider some pilot schemes. They could work with locals. And then without affecting the ecology, we could try to develop more destinations. In recent years, there's the trend of developing small towns with the government involved. They also bring in experienced operators to operate these facilities. So we could therefore develop such unique green tourism spots. Now they have stylish accommodation and catering services that cater to needs of different sectors. So this is the trend in other places. In Hong Kong, we could consider it too. And in fact, this is the trend on the mainland. They are developing towns with a special character. So in Hong Kong, we could also borrow the approach. Only then could we face the stiff competition, and then the tourism could continue to play an important role in the services industry. Thank you.
Mr. Michael TIEN, President, in the motion moved by Mr. Hsu Ka-fai, he talked about the government having good ample fiscal reserve and fiscal stability. The government should make good use of this public finance situation and improve people's livelihood and to open up new visitor resources. I agree. I don't know whether I'm the only one who do not support the government giving up money to the people. The government has all the money it needs. We should invest heavily in improving livelihood instead of trying to win the applause with short-term measures. And now the applause is no longer there, and the government is actually criticized. So I want to talk about the principle when we have a lot of fiscal reserves, we should set up dedicated funds to teach people how to fish, how to make wealth. So I'm talking about the tools for fishing today. I'm always in support of the development of underground space. And then we can solve the problem of insufficient space for the people to walk. We have seen a sales volume in the retail sector almost doubled, and land is in short supply. Everyone is surviving for the use of space. So we should go underground. There was a previous consultation. 80% of them were in favor of development of underground space. There are three options: under Victoria Carr, and one under Southern Bay Ground, and also another one under Kowloon Park. It seems to the government that the two in Kowloon Park and Southern playground would be more feasible, because there can be connection with Austin Station, the XRL Station, and West Kowloon. But we don't want to turn the underground space into another harbor city. I'm in the retail industry. I think what I'm going to say is convincing. We should go for diversity of shops. You should open up certain sectors for people to participate, and that would be better, more jobs for young people, and you can have space for different fairs with different themes. You can have green products this time, and then nostalgic products next time. We should allow young people the opportunities to do their business. If they make money, they would get a higher level of satisfaction than getting money from you. And there are many young people who would like to do this, because nowadays the government has been criticized for favoring one sector or another with different policies. It's a question of how you package it. In the promotion of the creative industries, the young people would be the strongest factor. We are talking about that we don't have resources for the six major arts and culture industries. In 2015, these industries account for 4.7% of GDP. And the other five under the big six contribute for only 2% or so. I recently visited a school. They developed an app to track the elderly people who are lost on their way, and the TV mode has been listed. It attracted the highest number of subscribers. Now its capitalization is $1.1 billion. We should give more space for young people. We have been asking for the development of a arts and cultural industry park, very much like the innovation park. That would allow the young people to develop their careers in the way they like. Apart from promotion of cultural and creative industries, many young people like to play sports. We should have multifunction venues for cycling, for long distance running. And recently, we have been talking about the review of private clubs. It seems that it's a zero-sum game. What I gain is what you lose. If there's a racing ground in Yamo, there will be no such problem. It's close to the airport. The purpose is for recreation. We've heard many people saying that we should go for development, but we should not just build more. Should not just have more buildings. I know that some officials have not really studied into the detail, into having something for the raising. Creative industries are about thinking out of the box, not about a new technology. I want to talk about the scale economy for raising. We have the Olympic Games every
4 years, but F1 races are held annually. I'm not just saying that we should go for F1 racing. On average, an event will last for 3 days and then 25,000 people a day. In EU, for a soccer match, there are 40,000. When there's a World Cup match, 50,000 spectators will be there. And the broadcast right is valuable. And altogether, 130 million viewers will watch the broadcast of Formula One races. And for theme parks, it's not easy to attract repeat visitors. So you need to add new things from time to time. I have friends who go to the Wimbledon tennis matches every year, they never get bored. According to some people, of Tongchung are concerned about noise problems. Of course, we should listen to them, but you should also carry out some research and explain what is involved. This is Tongchung to the south. The airport, this is Tongchung, this is the airport, this is the blue circle, and Yamo is the red circle. Because the airport will fly over your head, and the distance between the red circle and the blue circle is the distance between Chi-wan and equivalent of the distance between Chi-wan and Shang-wan. And they said the F1 cars would go from Central to Tongchung, and the cars are noisy. But we're not using the bridge as the race course. These cars costing you millions or tens of millions, they go in this container truck. I don't know whether it's an e-truck, but the point is that they won't be speeding race cars going all the way to Tongchung as suggested, when we have a lot of money. We should not spend it indiscriminately. It's time for making investments. If the government can manage such a complicated way of giving out money, they can certainly manage this suggestion. My suggestion will benefit various sectors. I am confident that the government can manage it if it's minded and determined to do it. Many people like to go to sports events, mega sports event, apart from World Cup matches. They are also interested in things related to car racing. As I've said, the Yamo car park is of a size that making around would be 5 km, so you can have a marathon event there. There's no need to seal off bridges and roads. And ordinary days, it can be used for training. We have a good cycling facility now, and this. One in Tongchung can also provide training facilities for cyclists. So this sports facility is a good value for money. It's much better than just give people money.
Mr. Wu Chi-wai, thank you. President. Now this motion is on stimulating internal demand and expanding the customer base. So now the government has so much resources, such a huge surplus. Where do we invest in to stimulate internal demand? Mr. Michael TIEN said just now that he's very much against a cash handout. I believe the general public have this perception. Now, when the government has a surplus, it wants to share the fruits of economic success, and then when it gives out cash, it has to do it in a fair manner. Otherwise, it should do as you, Mr. TIEN, you've suggested, that is, we invest in our future. We invest on dealing with various social issues. But unfortunately, the government's choice was to give cash handout, but not fairly and evenly, leading to a host of problems. So that's something we need to consider carefully. Now, the median forecast of the budget shows that in the next 5 years, even if government keeps increasing its spending by 2022, there will still be a fiscal reserve of $1.2 trillion, equivalent of 21 months of government spending. So how do we make use of this fiscal surplus? How do we make use of a fiscal reserve? We would all like the government to give it careful thought. The government said in its budget it's going to follow the example of the 10-year hospital redevelopment plan. So they're going to put $300 billion into developing hospitals. What about caring for the elderly? Is it the case that there's still no consensus within the government as to what we should do? How are we going to deal with the 458 residential homes for the elderly? So is it why, therefore, we don't see how the government is going to put in resources there? Primary health care, that's something the government has talked about for a long time. Mr. Wu, yes, I know, this is related. It's about stimulating internal demand. So investing in society is also a way to stimulate internal demand. So please let me finish, President. So what I'm trying to point out is that when we talk about stimulating internal demand, many members focus on investing in tourism industry and so on. But what about investing in the community, investing in our health? What about investing in the ways that the general public don't need to worry about the future? Well, that would bring another form of economic opportunities. Now, we have a graying population, so silver hair economy, that's also a possibility for investment in the future. Now, if the government invests in the future, people don't need to worry about the future. They will therefore be willing to spend. Instead of saving up their income for rainy days, they will be happy to spend it on day-to-day living needs, or on future training for future career opportunities. So don't pitch investing in the economy against investing in each and every of us in the community. So don't think that investing in the economy is investment, but in putting money in us is spending. No, don't think that way. Now, Mr. Zhou Xiaochuan, the governor of the People's Bank of China, once said that we need to reform healthcare and retirement, so that will help to stimulate internal demand. Now, in Hong Kong, we have a savings rate of 22%, among the top three in Southeast Asia. What does that mean? If we put away too much money in savings and we don't use it properly, that would not bode well for capital flow in a community. That's something we need to consider. Of course, we're not encouraging the public to spend money they don't have yet, but rather we need to lower the savings rate. So we could encourage more spending. I must stress again that government must make good use of its fiscal reserve to promote health care and elderly care services. And this is not actually a spending item, is the community will benefit from it. Now, first of all, the government must deal with policy objectives. That's squarely the duty of the government. If there's already consensus on policy matters, then the government must invest money in it, otherwise it becomes a problem. And actually, once the government makes a commitment, there will be other support services coming along. For example, the government has committed to providing 5,000 beds in the first 3 years, and it's also committing $300 billion to build hospitals. So then that means there will be land for that, and then there will be manpower required. So and that will in turn promote investment in social spending, and it's not merely an expenditure item as the government has thought. And also elderly care, that's about developing the great silver hair economy or market. Now, let's say you committed to providing providing manpower for the 458 homes, and so because of manpower shortage, maybe more automation will be brought in. And that in turn will promote the development of other industries. So you have to think of it that way. Don't remain bureaucratic in your mindset and consider these expenditure only. Now, I think it's already consensus that we have an aging population. Dr. Lau Chi Kwong has done many studies. By 2017, by 2027, we're going to have a serious problem of aging population, but then we still don't have enough homes for the elderly. Why? We're told because there's not sufficient land. So it's really a matter for the government to agree if it's a matter of priority. If that's the case, then the planning department could make the necessary arrangement because it has the flexibility to deal with GFA, and then we could supply enough land for building homes for the elderly. So that's why we have to be very careful in dealing with such issues. Now, there are already problems facing us, and then you still keep to the mindset that you only invest in the economy, but not in a very free future of Hong Kong people, then that's wrong. I hope you will change that attitude. This will allow us to make better use of existing resources. Now, if the government agrees to what we're suggesting, then the people won't be asking for a cash handout. And if people don't just ask for cash handout and you spend the money on all these areas I mentioned, everybody will be happy and there will be harmony. But if the government would only consider investing in the economy, then we can see a problem. Now, when we invest in the economy, yes, there will be positive impact and everybody will support it. So that's why I'm going to support your motion, Mr. Peter Shill. But anyway, what I'm saying that it's not enough just to invest in the economy. That's not the only solution to the problem. It's not the best way to use our fiscal surplus. So there's another part to your motion about expanding the customer base and so on, but I'll leave that to Mr. Lam Cheuk-ting. But I just want to make the points I've just made. I hope the government has heard me loud and clear. And in stimulating internal demand, don't just focus on the economic sector. But if there's improvement in other ways, then people don't have to worry about a future that will also help stimulate internal demand. Thank you.
Mr. Leung Lam Cheuk-ting, I thank Mr. Shiu Ka-fai for moving this motion on stimulating internal demand and opening up new visitor sources. The Democratic Party supports this motion. I will be focusing on tourism. The Democratic Party proposed that the government should take a hard look on the policy of tourism and the reception of visitors. In the past, 2 years, we have seen more than 50 million visitors coming to Hong Kong. According to these data, for those who claim to be mainland visitors who are here for leisure and shopping, there were 26 million of them. Among them, 16 million will not stay overnight. So mainland visitors coming to Hong Kong for shopping, and they will not stay overnight. So it shows that we have many non-overstaying mainland visitors coming over to Hong Kong to shop, and a large number will go to the North District, Yuen Long, and other places in NT. You shop either for your own use, or you are the parallel traders. You shop so that you can sell them onward for a profit. Of course, if you buy the groceries for your own use, that's okay. But we should not allow visitors to increase incessantly to the point of exceeding our capacity. Mr. Xiu Ka-fai proposes that we should enhance our capacity and capability. This is agreeable. We'd like to see a higher capacity to receive visitors and tourists, so that we won't give them a bad experience because of lack of facility, so that they don't think they are not well treated, they are slighted, or they are not getting good service, and they have to wait for a long time to get clearance at the checkpoints. We want to be a hospitable city, so we need to enhance our tourism capacity. But before we have achieved that, we should not expect a sudden and drastic increase of visitors, of visitor numbers, because that would mean a lot of pressure for different districts. The North District is already overburdened. I'm a district councillor for Shek-Wu-Hoi. Shek-Wu-Hoi is just next to Shangshui, the railway station. On a daily basis, there are tens of thousands of mainlanders coming to Cheuk-ting to shop, some for their own use, and some are parallel traders, creating a lot of pressure to the community. Prices and rent have increased tremendously. Many smaller shops and bookshops and stationery shops have been edged out, and people, residents there, cannot buy their daily necessities, their groceries there. They will have to go a long way or to pay high prices for these goods, and the supply can easily be depleted, and you have to wait for replenishment. And even for shampoo, and a few years ago we have a problem with baby formula. This is most unsatisfactory, and also there's a lot of crowded streets, because these are shop mainland visitors who just open their suitcases on the road, on the street, because that's Cheuk-ting. The width of the pavement is just 2 meters, and with a suitcase open in the middle so that they can sort their goods and the refuse, the cup, and the cardboard cartoon is discussed everywhere. The street becomes very messy and chaotic, and people are aggrieved and unhappy about this. A few years ago, in Shangshui, there was an arson case involving a shop selling goods to parallel traders. Of course, we cannot condone such acts. And actually, the culprit was arrested by the police. What is even more shocking to me is that a few days after that, I heard from many residents that it was good. There should be more arsons set to these shops. They want to see more
such cases. And I told them that there are tenement buildings, there are dwellings on the upper floors, that they should not think like that. But the point is that don't ignore the grievances of people. It's been mentioned that a few years ago there were protesters targeting the apparel traders and visitors with some sort of uncivilized way of dealing with people, such as they would kick their suitcases, the suitcases of visitors. But the sentiment is commonly felt. If you ask people in Tuen Mun and Yuen Long and North District, they are deeply aggrieved by these chaos. It's because the government, while developing the tourism the industry, ignore the question of capacity in the districts. And when we proposed putting a cap on the growth of visitors numbers, and they said that we are proud before we have even become rich. And now we propose that there was the one trip per week policy. We cannot say that Hong Kong's economy will bloom, although there will be a lot of overcrowded streets. Are local residents reaping the benefits of such economic activities? No, but they will have to suffer in terms of higher rents for shopping premises or for the domestic premises. And the prices are not affordable to them, and they have to move farther and farther away from the central location. So we shouldn't rely on the mainland market alone. So the SAR government should do more promotion overseas, so that we will not have a homogeneous source. If we solely rely on the mainland market, and there should be a change of policy or economic downturn on the mainland, our tourism industry will suffer big repercussions. And now with the one trip per week policy in place, the situation is not improved significantly. It should be changed to 8 trips per year. We have looked at the average number of visits by mainland visitors. We propose a limit of 8 trips per year. Making 8 visits to a city a year would be quite good enough. And even there's no need to go to a city for shopping so frequently. We also want to have a boundary shopping facilities. I'm not talking about Mr. Wong Ting Kwong's project. That's a failure. That the project fails to attract visitors, and also no local people are attracted to that. It's a total failure. I'm proposing doing this at Lok Ma Chau, close to the MTR station. Choose a convenient location so that the tourists who are visitors who are coming over to shop would be able to do so quickly and then return to the mainland. And we also want to have more manpower to control order. There are only 7 constables and 1 sergeant for the entire Shangshui and Fanling. I have asked the police and the commissioner of police to increase manpower, and they always refuse. And the commissioner count the boundary division manpower into the calculation. But you cannot really do this. The boundary division are for cross-boundary visitor number. This is the most misleading.
Secretary for Commerce and Economic Development. President, people's livelihood and economy are issues closest to the heart of the public. The government appreciates the public aspirations for good lives. That's why the government's always been working hard to promote people's livelihood and economic development. In recent years, the community faces different challenges. Public expectation of the government has also been evolving. Many believe the government should be proactive appropriately to promote diversified economy and provide a better business environment. This will provide more job opportunities to different sectors of the community, and then they could benefit from the from our economic development. In recent years, the government has been ploughing more resources in improving healthcare, education, and social welfare services. In 2018 to 19, we have recurrent spending of more than $1,230 billion in these three areas. That accounts for 60% of government spending. In the recent 5 years, the cumulative growth in spending for these areas is 42.8%. In the 2017 October policy address, the chief executive has announced new initiatives on helping the poor, the elderly, the weak, and also housing issues. For example, the introduction of the non-means-tested public transport fare subsidy scheme and the improvement to the low-income working family allowance scheme and so on. In the budget announced by the financial secretary last month, he also ensures there are sufficient resources to implement the various measures the policy address, and also to make use of the fiscal surplus to introduce a series of measures that will benefit the public and businesses. In fact, if we want to stimulate internal demand, the fundamental approach is stimulating economic growth. So the government has been actively promoting the emerging industries other than traditional industries. This is including creative industries. This will provide young people with more quality job opportunities. Governments also plow the resources to promote innovation and technology. That we provide research funds for universities. We also have means to encourage talents to come to Hong Kong, and also R&D organizations to come to Hong Kong. Now we have 330,000 SMEs that account for 90% of our local businesses, so they are the pillar of our economy. That's why we've always been promoting a good environment for the development of SMEs and in turn stimulate economic growth. Last October, in the policy address, the government has announced strategic taxation measures to help SMEs. For the first $2 million of profit, the profit tax will be dropped to 8.25%, which is half of the existing profit tax rate. And there are measures also to promote diversity in our economy and the development of different industries. This is to enhance Hong Kong's competitive edge. The referendum bill has been passed by this council on the 21st of March. And also the budget has proposed injecting $1 billion to the SME Export Marketing and Development Funds. And there are also enhanced measures to and strengthen support for SMEs. For the SME Export Marketing Fund, we propose that for individual SMEs under this fund, the cumulative funding ceiling will be increased from $300,000 to $400,000. As for the funding ceiling for each application, it will be increased from $50,000 to $100,000. Also, we will remove the existing condition on the use of the last $50,000 of grants. And the budget also announced injecting $1.5 billion to the dedicated fund on branding, upgrading, and domestic sales spot fund. And then for the enterprise support scheme, the cumulative funding ceiling for enterprises undertaking projects in the mainland will be increased from $500,000 to $1 million. And then there will be extension of the geographical scope of the enterprise support program to include the Asian countries. Cumulative funding ceiling for enterprises undertaking projects in Asian countries will also be $1 million. To promote the economy, we need to seize upon the opportunities brought about by the Better Road Initiative and the Guangdong Hong Kong Macau Bay Area Development. The Belt and Road Initiative is a key long-term development strategy of the nation. It will also be a key growth engine for Hong Kong. The government will take a multi-pronged approach to promote Hong Kong's participation in the Belt and Road Initiative. And they will strengthen cooperation with Belt and Road countries and regions and enhance our competitive edge. The Secretary for Commerce and Economic Development has recently led a delegation of 48 business and businessmen and professionals to visit Cambodia and Vietnam. This is for them to explore opportunities along the Belt and Road region. At the same time, the government will continue to consolidate and upgrade our traditional pillar industries, including the financial services, shipping and logistics industry, professional services, and tourism industries, which is a key concern in this motion. This will provide a stable economic growth. The tourism industry is one of the key four pillar industries of Hong Kong. It accounts for 5% of GDP. It has also created 260,000 jobs for grassroots sector, different workforces. And that includes also the retail industry, business, hotel industry, and so on. Now, to ensure the stable and healthy development of the tourist industry will help to promote economic growth in Hong Kong. There has been change in the visitor structure and the spending pattern of visitors in recent years. Also, we face competition from neighboring regions, so the government has already adjusted our development strategy for the tourism industry. We are now focusing on attracting more overnight stay visitors. The industry and the government have been working hard, and also there's been improvement in the external environment. So this year we see momentum picking up again for the industry, for the tourism industry. The overall visitor numbers in 2017 has gone up by 3.62%, and the fourth quarter has gone up by 6%. Now, to further enhance our competitiveness as a tourist destination, in this first in the first policy address of this term of government, there's an announcement of the development blueprint for Hong Kong's tourism industry. It is a forward-looking plan on the development of the tourism industry by implementing various short, medium to long-term tourism initiatives and measures systematically in the coming 4-5 years. The vision and mission of the blueprint is to develop Hong Kong into a world-class premier tourism destination and to ensure the balanced, healthy and sustainable development of the industry. There are 4 development strategies, 13 implementation goals and 72 initiatives. The government has announced in the budget funding of $396 million. Of that, $226 million are going to the Hong Kong Tourism Board and $170 million are going to the Tourism Commission. This is for implementing the blueprint. Now, members have expressed various concerns about various issues. For example, the SL government is very much concerned about parallel trading and the nuisance they've caused. The relevant law enforcement agencies have been taking multi-pronged measures to improve the situation along the boundary. For example, in the MTRO areas, the MTRO-CL is working closely with the government to impose a limit on the size of luggage and also the weight of luggage. Also, there are notices to remind passengers of the restrictions on the size and weight of luggage. And for those carrying large luggage, they must not use the escalators and so on. And then the Immigration Department has also compiled a blacklist of parallel traders. If they have doubts about the purpose of visit of those suspected parallel traders, they will be turned back. There are also targeted measures too, and that include working closely with the relevant mainland authorities on immigration control. For illegal parking of coach buses and a congregation of tourist groups are causing congestion in certain local streets, we also closely monitoring the situation. We've also reminded the various industries to or the relevant departments to control the crowd. This is to make sure that coach bus drivers follow the relevant requirements. And the Travel Industry Council also issues notices from time reminding coach bus drivers to park legally.
And advice will be given to tour guides to properly manage their tours. However, to effectively control the situation, we need the joint effort of shops, coaches, tour guides, and the industry's practitioners. In this regard,
The Travel Industry the Tourism Commission has been regularly meeting representatives from the government departments and the industry, and will also appeal to them to make use of information technology to enhance crowd control and traffic management. For example, real-time applications should be used, and there should also be instant chat rooms for communication between stakeholders, and there should also be video cameras installed in restaurants so that the shop operators will be in a better position to manage different tour groups. And in October 2017, a high-level meeting was also convened. The relevant parties, including relevant issues, were discussed, including illegal parking of coaches.
That is to encourage coaches to use proper parking spaces. That includes increase the number of loading, unloading, drop-off pickup points. And through the use of short-term lease, they are allowed to use spaces in public car parks. Say, for example, for just half an hour. The government will also closely monitor the situation to see if there is any more inconvenience caused to neighborhoods. If the situation remains unchanged, then the tourism authority will formulate measures targeting the problem, say for example recalcitrant offenders and travel agents offering mainland inbound tours, and there will be sanctions. I hope that we can make use of today's debate to listen to members' views on the improvement of livelihood as well as promotion of the economy. And I will give a concluding reply afterwards. Thank you.
Mr. Tony Chair. Thank you. Mr. President. Mr. President, I subscribe to the views of Mr. Chiu Ka-fai as laid out in his motion. We should stimulate internal demand and open up new visitor sources. I also agree with Mr. Xu that the government should step up its efforts in providing tourism supporting facilities to enhance our capability and capacity. I think we agree that at the moment, the relevant facilities are in great shortage. If you have time to take the MTR, or if you have time to visit busy tourism spots such as Mong Kok and Causeway Bay, you would know that it's heavily congested. During peak hours, you may need to wait for several departures before you could get on a train. And on busy streets, many pedestrians are forced to walk on the carriageway, causing unnecessary danger. The government, in planning for the use of resources, should consider the tourism needs and provide the necessary supporting facilities. For example, whether there are sufficient parking spaces for coaches. As mentioned by the Secretary just now, the point is that people are not following the law because there aren't sufficient parking spaces. In terms of the road design, consideration should be given whether there is sufficient capacity for people as well as traffic. Before adding new tourist attractions, all these facilities should be factored in at the planning stage. And earlier, I suggested that the MTR should consider providing a larger space for standing passengers in trains, and I have successfully strived for the ratio to be reduced from 6 to 5. That is 5 passengers per 1 square meter. In terms of improving the density of passengers on trains and at tourist spots, well, since many tourists are carrying luggages or wearing backpacks on their backs, the MTRCL should further consider lowering the improving the standards for space occupied by standing passengers. According to the International Tourism Organization, sustainability in the tourism industry can not only meet the needs of tourists and the host countries, it can also protect and bring about more opportunities for development in the future. So, Mr. President, how are we going to incorporate tourism in our traditional culture? That's very important. For example, for new tourist attractions or in terms of restoration of cultural heritage, we have a lot of young architects, engineers, planners, landscape artists, etc., who are very innovative. And if we could hold competitions more often, and I mean design competitions for tourism facilities, the winning party will be able to take up the relevant project after the competition, which will add unique characteristics to the districts concerned, and the government will also be able to cultivate talents and cultivate the sense of belonging among them and improve the branding of Hong Kong. Hong Kong is a small city. If we can develop ourselves into an ideal walkable city, we'll be able to attract more tourists on top of facilitating local pedestrians. And we have experts in this area who can give full play to their potential so that even the side streets in Hong Kong can become a tourist attraction. A U.S. designer, G.F. Speck, once said that to build a walkable city, we're not just talking about the road space being shared by pedestrians as well as traffic. It should also be a sphere for pedestrians to build this relationship with the shops in the streets. And for the NYC Plaza program, it allows non-profit making organizations to convert streets with low usage utilization into open space, and the government would subsidize the plan, the design and construction of the plaza. And the non-profit making organizations and the residents of that the area will be responsible for detailed design. And there will be a lot of restrictions, for example, no advertisement, and the revenue from the lease of venues could only be plowed back for the maintenance and repair of the plaza. In such a way, we can build a vibrant open space for use by the people. And I think we can draw reference from this example. Hong Kong has 18 districts. We have district councils in every district. I think the district council can also play a role in this through the help of professionals and through collaborating with non-profit making organizations. We can design and run our own street plaza in Hong Kong. Mr. President, to stimulate internal demand, we should make sure that our economy is robust so that people's livelihood can be improved. If we need to open up new visitor sources, we need to have proper and new tourist attractions to be enjoyed by locals as well as tourists. I urge the district councils to step up their effort in keeping the streets clean and managing the district, and incorporate more talents in the design and construction of these facilities so that these attractions will carry their own characteristics. Mr. Kenneth Lau. Thank you, Mr. President. First of all, I thank Mr. Cheuk Ka-fai for moving today's motion. The motion is on stimulating internal demand and opening up new visitor sources. In terms of the theme of a pluralistic economy, investing for the future and caring for the people, they will be put to that they will be translated into action. Well, the surplus and the reserve for 2017-18 would be $138 billion and $1,092 billion respectively as a result of increase in land sale revenue. It's a hard to come by opportunity. The economy may soon reach a downturn cycle and our economy would turn for the worse. That is why we need to grasp this opportunity to identify new growth points and prepare for the future development of Hong Kong. Today's motion sets out a direction in this regard. Well, as far as the budget is concerned, we should create wealth and return wealth to the people so that people's consumption power will be enhanced and then internal demand can be stimulated. At the same time, we should also attract new visitor sources so that we can broaden our economic base and diversify our economic base. But I think this debate should be postponed until we have the budget debate, and I'd like to air my views on this motion. The tourism industry is one of the four pillar industries in Hong Kong. There are over 270,000 people employed in the travel industry and the relevant industries. And for the two consecutive years, visitor figures have continued to drop. Fortunately, in 2017, decline in visitor figures tapered off, but at the same time, we need to enhance our tourism supporting facilities. We are a highly modernized metropolis. Many tourists, when coming to Hong Kong, will visit theme parks, do the shopping in urban districts, and try the local food. And tourist attractions should not be confined to the traditional ones or those in urban districts. We should attract new visitors by creating new tourism spots. Otherwise, we may lose even the regular visitors, and we may be overtaken by the neighboring cities and places. Mr. President, 40% of our land in Hong Kong is country parks. The objective of zoning these sites as country parks is to provide recreational and tourism space for the people, as there were developments elsewhere in Hong Kong. According to statistics, annually, 12 million visitors would go to country parks, and during festive seasons, there would be hiking tours, and the government should make use of our natural landscape and the rural areas to develop ecotourism. Last year, Mr. YIU Si-wing moved a motion on leveraging on our advantages in developing the tourism industry. I already mentioned that in other countries, hiking trails would often be accompanied by lodges and other types of accommodation that allows hikers to take a rest. A lot of hiking trails in Hong Kong are in rural areas. As long as the government offers help in restoring these remote rural villages so that there would be proper utilities installed, then accommodation and F&B services can be provided to visiting hikers. And on the other hand, we can conserve the ecology. The restricted area in Sha Tau Kwok is also one of the potential tourism spots. Sha Tau Kwok has the pillbox and other heritage buildings, and visitors could take a ferry to Kat O and Lai Chi Wall to visit these special places. It's been 20 years since Hong Kong was returned to the mainland China. The historic reason is gone. There is no reason for us to keep Sha Tau Kwok a closed area. It should be developed into a tourism spot instead. At the moment, it is very difficult for tourists as well as locals to access Chongying Street. On the other hand, we could join a tour on the mainland to explore Chongying Street. And this is due to the closed area policy of Sha Tau Kwok. In fact, these new visitor sources are available. The government, however, drags on its feet. The government should remove obstacles, remove red tape, and enhance the hardware and give more support. these suggestions would make Hong Kong more attractive and be able to attract more visitors. We can also keep the rural characteristics. We need to keep the rural village culture. Well, today's motion will be responded by the Secretary for Commerce and Economic Development. However, we need effort across different bureaus. I hope that after hearing members' suggestions, the government would take a careful look into the issue so that the bureaus could make a coordinated effort to do good for Hong Kong.
Mr. Ma Fong Kwok.
President, Mr. Shiu has moved a motion very close to the heart of Hong Kong people. The government is sitting on very healthy reserves and surpluses. Of course, we should return wealth to the people by promoting different programs to improve people's livelihood, but at the same time, you should also take the opportunity to promote economic development. I believe most members have no quibbles about the original motion. However, when we come to the details, we can really discuss this more. Talking about livelihood, of course, housing is the most important thing. In the first quarter of 2018, housing prices have shot by 5% again. And also those in the waiting list for PRH are crammed into subdivided units in very poor living conditions. Most of the people's income is spent on meeting their housing needs, and they have little left to spend. And where can we start to talk about promoting internal demand? The government should provide adequate housing so prices and rents would come back to a reasonable level, so people have the ability to have money to spend. However, we lack land that can be used for housing, for elderly homes, for recreation. We need land for everything. But because of the insufficient supply of land, industries also suffer because they do not have land for development. Now, this is not the topic today, but then when we talk about improving people's livelihood and promoting internal demand, I think housing is a very important element, and I hope the task force on land supplies proposals will be rationally discussed by society. Two, about improving people's livelihood and stimulating internal demand, legislative councillors have a role to play here. In fact, the administration has proposed measures in order to stimulate the economy and also people's livelihood. However, when these come to the Legislative Council, they were subject to filibustering. Last year, 130 billion worth of projects came to the Legislative Council for scrutiny, but only 58 billion worth of projects were supported and approved. Even for this year, the speed of work at the FC is still at a snail's pace. I hope members will now really treat the backlog with more support. And also in the motion, it says that we should increase our visitor receiving capability and capacity. I believe this should be taken up by an independent bureau, and cultural and other policies should be reviewed and developed. I have said that we should really set up a cultural and recreational bureau in order to give the full play to this issue. In 2017, you can look at the increase of 3.9 and 2.9% when we talk about short-haul visitors from the mainland and other places. But then for long-haul visitors, there has been a drop of 1%, and from emerging markets, a drop of 11.9%. We should target different markets and roll out different measures, especially those from high-spending areas. We should attract them to come to Hong Kong to understand our culture. And also, we should review the individual visit scheme and also cruise tours so we can develop new sources of visitors. At the same time, you should also review our attractions, and at the same time, you should start the building of the Palace Museum in West Kowloon, and also develop Kai Tak and Lan Tau. Also, we can consider having a cultural innovation park. At the same time, we cannot neglect the impact on Hong Kong people from visitors. We must look at the burden brought on our railways and other modes of transport. We can develop more rail lines so as to tackle the need. And for places mostly visited by mainland people, you should review the facilities, especially coach parking spaces. And the departments should set up standing coordination measures with the companies that bring in these visitors. And also, we have already started the Boundary Shopping Center, but then after it started its business last month, it seems it was not very much frequented. But it actually has a very good role to play in streaming mainland visitors who want to shop in Hong Kong. I hope the administration will persuade the travel agencies to take visitors there, and if necessary, please provide the necessary transport links so you bring more people to the shopping center on the boundary. And in the long term, we can repeat the same experience at other checkpoints. All in all, I hope you will pay more attention to livelihood, to improve people's living, and also to provide more tourist facilities and minimize the impact on Hong Kong people. Thank you. Ms. Priscilla Leung. President, I speak in support of the original motion, and also I like to concentrate on the point of tourism. I like to say that my party colleague, Mr. Jeffrey Lam, has moved an amendment, and we support the direction of that amendment. I will concentrate on this point of tourism, and I have heard many members say that in terms of long-term planning, how we can provide more facilities to complement the effort. But what I want to say is that we have a lot of good resources which are not put to good use. If you can have good policies, I'm sure you can bring in immediate improvements. Talking about tourism, we have to talk about accessibility, degree of comfort, spending points, and how we can deal with different groups of visitors of different age groups, and how can we really be a hospitable city. One of the most precious resources in Hong Kong is, of course, our Victoria Harbour. On the two sides of Victoria Harbour, is that put to good use? From the tourist point of view, are we already maximizing the potential of the Victoria Harbour? Talk about accessibility. I know West Kowloon very well, and even we can talk about East Kowloon because we already have the Energizing East Kowloon project. We had hoped that there would be a promenade linking up East and West Kowloon. By accessibility, we have said that at the District Council, there was this unanimous view. The Kai Tak Cruise Terminal is going to waste. Many of the shops can't survive there. It is because of poor accessibility. If you drive there, you will have to make so many bends and turns before you can reach the main building. You should therefore put the Kai Tak Cruise Terminal to the best use. Talking about transportation and tourism, we also said that you should develop sea transport. I heard that there is a pier near the cruise terminal. If you can add 3 million to it, the sampans can be kick-started. And also, you should implement the idea of water taxis ASAP. From the cruise terminal to Hong Hum, now we have developed the Hong Hum waterfront to a promenade. How can we link all this up with the cultural district and also Tsim Sha Tsui? Hong Ham Pier is also a typical example. In 2011, you scrapped the ferry routes and now it's lying in waste. You can enliven it. You can allow sale kiosks and local artists and even catering points to stay there, like Black Pier. But now it is lying in waste. People who go there would ask, why are we wasting our resources? This is the waterfront. I hope you can develop water taxis. You may think that it is a small project, but I would say that you should make better use of ferries. It's a sea transport tool, and it can help relieve our land transport. But think about it. Many Hong Kong people of our generation took the ferry to work and to go back home. It's our collective memory. And to tourists, it is also a good way to see Hong Kong. You can take a ferry and enjoy the harbor. It's inexpensive, it's very comfortable. But you are scrapping ferry routes. I think it is because you have a calcified mind. You will always view the ferries as just a transport carrier, and you don't want to subsidize it for other purposes. In fact, ferries can be pegged to tourism and development. So please, have some new thinking. You should not just enliven the Hong Ham Pier and Kai Tak Cruise Terminal. Look at your policy. People don't just want your $1 million or $2 million subsidy, but policy-wise, how can you, for example, make better advertising policies, and if you can also allow caterers to go there, people would be brought there and people would be taking the ferries. It's just like Wan Chai North. You have started the design or the consultation on design of the waterfront city concept. Why is it that you have done nothing for the Hong Ham to Tsim Sha Tsui waterfront? It is a promenade, all right, but why don't you add a cultural element to it? How can you have a promenade with different themes? And also, why don't you develop water sports so that you can breathe some life into the area? We have always had this dream. If we can link up the waterfront between East and West Kowloon, can we plant flowers and plants with different colors on the two sides? It can be so beautiful. Look at the waterfront in overseas cities. Go to Australia and other places. They have a thriving catering industry there. Well, I'm not saying you should go for catering, but you should allow it to have some content where appropriate. Then you can have places where people will spend money. You can copy the mode of spending in different districts, and tourists love the ferries. You know, you can allow them to do both in peak hours. Residents will be able to take the ferries to go to North Point, Wan Chai, and Central. But in the non-peak hours, people should be able to take ferries after they have disembarked from cruises to go to Tsim Sha Tsui instead of taking coaches and be stuck in a traffic jam. So accessibility. Secretary, think about this. This is an immediate measure you can take.
Mr. Elvin Yeung, thank you. I would like to thank Mr. Cheuk Ka-fai for moving this motion. We can talk about this topic on two parts. First, to make good use of our finances in order to drive internal demand and improve people's livelihood. The second part is to upgrade our receiving capability and capacity. When it comes to internal demand, well, economics tells us that it comes from from different components. Well, capital input, visitors, spending, etc. Well, for The Economist, 2017, there was a passage about it. But when it comes to the second quarter, 2.3% of 2016 has increased to 6.3% to the fourth quarter of 2017. Out of the many expenditures, private consumption is the strongest. 2016, 1.9%. 2017, it has increased to 2.4%. For the fourth quarter, it's an increase to 6.3%. So it's the best performing year in the past 5 years. When it comes to private consumption, it's next to export of goods, which drives Hong Kong's economy. In the past 5 years, employment is good in Hong Kong. Consumer sentiment is also good. And I would like to look at the administration's spending in the past few years. It seems that there is a lot of room for the administration to improve. In 2017, it was 3.4%. It's around this percentage in the past few years. 2012, government spending increase was 3.6%. 2013, 2.7%. Last year, 3.4%. It seems that there is still a lot of room for the administration to do more. I can glean something interesting from it. First, whether the administration should give cash handouts. We should think about it. Of course, giving cash handout to the public will increase their consumption sentiment. However, there is a risk. Where will the cash be put? Will they be saved? Will it directly stimulate the economy? If the administration is willing to spend where is needed, say for example, it can spend on infrastructure, and if resources can be spent to improve livelihood, that would be great. These include universal retirement protection, other resources to tackle an aging population, say for example, specialist care as well as dental care. Members of the public don't have to spend too much of their money on these things. And so what they're given, they will spend on private consumption. In the economic report, there is also some figures about tourism. It shows that we need new thinking. The current pattern will not drive internal demand before 2014 because we benefited from an increasing number of visitors from individual visit screen. For the 2 years before 2014, it was 27.4%, and then it drops from 15.8%. Last year, it has increased. 2012, inbound visitors of 4.8 million, 2014, 60 million, 2016, 56 million. Last year, it has increased to 58 million. Well, we have about 14 million visitors coming from other places. So we have a majority of visitors coming from the mainland. That is a problem. We have relied too heavily on mainland visitors. And it seems that it has reached a plateau. A local tourism, has it put all the eggs in one basket? Is it too too centralized? This affects our tourism ecosystem. If there are changes in mainland policies, then they will be affected. Say, for example, gold shops in tourism areas, they have been closing down. This is worrying. We can't just chase after numbers. We need to focus on quality as well. People's livelihood has been affected. I don't want to repeat about the inconvenience caused by people under the individual scheme. I hope the administration will not politicize this topic. They often say that whenever it comes to criticism targeting mainland visitors, they said that it is political. If there is an excessive number of visitors in a certain area, it's a problem. Japan, Venice, Thailand, they all suffer from the same problem. We need to try to strike a balance between tourism and people's livelihood. Well, that can be ecotourism, that can be national parks, that can be a limit on the inbound visitors. And we need to develop the tourism with local features. We need to promote ecotourism and tourism for cultural culture, and not just a brand or designer brand. Ms. Tanya Chen is very concerned about state theater. Well, if we can be properly preserved and developed, that would be good. But we can't just talk about conservation without doing anything. Well, the Civic Party will support Mr. Xiu Ka-fai's regional motion. Ms. Claudia Mo. There is good intentions in the original motion. However, it only links internal demand with tourism. I think there is a problem with that logic. I've read through all these amendments. I think the only meaningful one is that from Mr. Lam Cheuk-ting. However, he has not crossed out improve up Hong Kong's visitor receiving capability and capacity. I would like to talk to you about figures. Yes, tourism is a huge pillar of Hong Kong's economy. It accounts for about 5% of GDP. It's not a small number, nor is it a big number. But if you say that we can just rely on tourism, this will drive Hong Kong's economic development, I don't agree. But there are problems with the individual visit scheme. We see a whole street full of pharmacies and gold shops. We've been talking about it for 5 years. And in the end, Chi-wai Lung agreed, perhaps he didn't. But perhaps he received an order. We said that, if there are too many people from the individual visit scheme, Hong Kong will sink. Well, then later it was changed to one visit per week. And in 2017, for the whole year, there are still about 60 million visitors coming to Hong Kong. Close to 60 million visiting Hong Kong over a year. The figure, 60 million, is abnormal. Look at other metropolis, international metropolis, Paris, a lot of people go there, New York, the Big Apple, London. You can get a glimpse of the royal family. There are only about 20, 30 million visitors. For international visitors, going to New York is just about 10 million. Hong Kong. In Hong Kong, there are 60 million. It's simply crazy. And you still want to upgrade Hong Kong's receiving capability and capacity is too much. If you want more figures, say Paris, is no more than 30 million, including French nationals going to Paris, not inbound visitors. New York. In 2016, there may be more visitors than Hong Kong. 60 million. We have less than 60 million. But the figure of New York shows that most of the visitors are Americans. For international visitors, just about 10 million. In Causeway Bay, well, there was a time when you couldn't even buy a mop. But it is said that there was a slight drop in the number of visitors in the past 2 years, so you want to upgrade Hong Kong's receiving capability and capacity. Well, if you say that you want to increase the number, I don't think so. We don't need it. We need some breathing space. And Causeway Bay should not be overcrowded. We have 60 million. It's well known. 70% of them come from the mainland. About 10,000 of them are visitors not staying overnight. For in other countries, they are not counted. But in Hong Kong, there is this strange phenomenon, parallel goods traders. And this problem is unresolved. Now you want to move this motion. I haven't made up my mind. I don't know whether to support or oppose. Do you know that in Tokyo, from Hokkaido to Okinawa, they say that there may be 40 million. And in Hong Kong, just over a year, including parallel goods traders, close to 60 million. And you want more? And you make it sound like Hong Kong will die without tourism. But we have other industries. If you want to drive internal demand, well, what about 170 hectares of the golf course? You can resume the land and build public housing there so that people will have a roof over their heads. And then there will be internal demand. Because people's living standard has improved because of after they have a roof over their heads. And I find it strange. Michael Tien said that he strongly opposes cash handouts. I know that we shouldn't talk about cash handouts here, but he said it. And I would like to say this. Well, we have a lot of money in our public coffer because of the high land price policy, because of the land sales program. There is a lot of red capital here in Hong Kong. So we have a lot of money in our reserve, but I don't see any long-term policies or measures. And people don't trust the administration, the government. That's why they would like to get cash handouts.
Mr. Jeremy Tam. Mr. President, according